like this. Living a life true to ourselves is pretty intense, actually. It sounds kind of simple. I remember, I was quote this, lately I discovered this Australian nun, no, not a nun, sorry, a nurse, Australian nurse, I remember hearing about her in England. And then she wrote a book, she'd been working with people, working with the dying. And she said, and the book is called The Five Greatest Regrets of the Dying. And surprisingly, the greatest regret, you know, the cliched idea is that you didn't climb Mount Everest or something, you know. But the greatest regret, and this is the point I'm getting at, it's a really sobering point. The greatest regret of the dying was that I didn't listen to my own heart. I didn't do what I really wanted to do, but instead did what I thought other people wanted me to do. So first of all, it seems very noble, doesn't it, to do what other people want. It sounds like sacrificing yourself, it sounds like compassion. And amazing, you hear all the amazing stories of bodhisattvas sacrificing their lives, you know. You hear about, for example, when I was working for Mandala magazine, Mother's Open and Loving Issues magazine of the FPMT, and I was editor in the 90s and a few years in California. And every now and again, Lama Zobra Rinpoche would send letters from his students and get us to publish them, but anonymously. But they were about their practice. And it was the letters that were really moving, showing these amazing realizations of these people, you know? Because it's very inspiring for us Westerners who always think, oh, yeah, Tibetans are yogis, Tibetans have realizations, you know, we're creeps. It was very, always very moving to see, to hear about the experiences of ordinary Americans, ordinary people with you know, realizations. So there was one person who, on the face of it, you'd feel sorry for. He was in his 50s. He lived in a house taking care of his old auntie who had cancer. Now, that's exactly the kind of person you'd feel sorry for, who you'd think was sacrificing his life for someone else, who wasn't following what he really wanted to do. But in fact was, it sounded like from his meditations that he was a great meditator, a great yogi, a bodhisattva. So he was actually doing exactly what he wanted to do, which included practicing these extraordinary levels of compassion. Now, most of us don't have those levels of compassion. Most of us, the compassion we do have now, are mixed completely with our attachment. So, the compassion we have now is our own attachment pollutes our ability to help others, pollutes our ability to really sacrifice ourselves for others, as we sort of think. Many people sacrifice their lives, but they're living in frustration, in pain, in regret, in fear, in loss, in having nothing, not knowing what they want to do, and not being able to do what they want. So it's not really noble. It's actually incredible suffering. And much of the time, because of this attachment, this particular one, which is so primordial, and is probably the deepest attachment. I think Rinpoche has said, the one that is the hardest to get rid of. So let's look at this one. This is the point we're getting to. Which is not attachment to sex, bodies, food, power, money, drugs, no. Attachment to what people think of us. In Tibetan Buddhist psychology, they call it attachment to reputation. It sounds kind of boring, you know. Oh, yeah, I don't mind what people think. We say, meaning whether you're successful or not in the world. Reputation sounds like a big deal. But it's this one of attached to what other people think of us. And this one is so deep inside us. It's actually the one that runs the show. It's the one that prevents us from not only not following our heart, but from not even knowing what we want. Most of us don't even know what we want, you know. We don't even know what we'd really like to do. We're too scared to even think it, because we're mostly trying to be a good girl, trying to be a good boy, trying to do what trying to do what we think the world expects, what mummy expects, daddy expects, who knows what the they out there expect. Fearful of even daring to look into what we think ourselves and trying to fit into other people's plans. But it's even that seems gross. It's really more subtle than that. It's very hard to see it. It's almost as if it determines most choices we make. And it's the basis also of, it's so connected to the very neurotic sense, the deepest sense of self we seem to have, this wrong sense of self, this wrong ego, that it seems to me that this attachment is the feeling of it is that I am only valid when other people say so. When other people, hello, Robina, that was a good thing you did. We're yearning for this all the time. And so the moment a person doesn't accept us, doesn't agree with us, or indeed turns against us, it's like a nightmare, you know? Because this attachment, this neediness to be approved of, this neediness to be seen by others, as if I'm nobody until I'm seen by others. That's, and this is so deep inside us. And so the pain of loss and loneliness is based on this one. Look at loneliness. What is loneliness, you know? Having no one in front of me to hear my thoughts, as we call it, to share. Wonderful, but it sounds good, you know? So on a conventional sense, we are creatures, we're social creatures. We live in groups, you know, amazing. And this is where all our practice of compassion is. It's incredible. But it's where our practice of attachment is. And that's the nightmare. So we don't, and we don't think we're real until we have a partner. We don't think we're real until we have a friend. We don't think we exist until we're seen by others as being good. Even look at what we mean in the world by success. By definition, it's what other people think of us. You can be the best pianist on earth, but if nobody thinks you are, you want to kill yourself. Because why? Because this enormous attachment, this neediness to have others, to other what other people think of us, indicates we have no sense of value in ourselves. It's logical. It's just logical. Why would I be so frantic, and I mean frantic, to have someone else think I'm good? Because I don't think I am, until I hear it from someone else. It's like, well, I mean, yes, he would sort of joke, but he was serious. I mean, this is the depth of ego. And this is the irony of ego. And he said, like, you're schizophrenic. You know? So this is ordinary behavior. But it's so subliminal. It's so instinctive. It's what drives us most of the time. You know, when you hear the Tibetans and you see this, one of the latest books of Rinpoche's that Lama Yeshe Wisdom Archive has put out about the eight worldly dharmas. It seems so abstract to us, the eight worldly dharmas. God, what's that? Well, this is the main one. It's these deeper, more primordial, pervasive levels of attachment. So when we learn Buddha's teachings from the very beginning, the very simple levels of Buddha's teachings, the basic level, which is already profound, which is the level of learning to control our body and speech, not harm, not lie, not kill, not steal, not bad mouth. This is all because of attachment. Why would I kill? Because someone upset me. Why am I upset? Because that's the response when attachment doesn't get what it wants. Why do I eat too much food? Because I'm craving for something. Why do I keep wanting to jump on new boyfriends? Because I'm, feel empty without it. So the general idea of attachment, the simple word, is this. The main energy of attachment, and Buddha would say we get born with it, is dissatisfaction. It seems so weird and contradictory. Dissatisfaction. With what? Well, with what I've got, with who I am, with what's in front of me, with people, things, that amount of cake, whatever, and it's myself mostly. This is a terrible, the irony of ego is this. It's as if we don't think we exist. We're nothing until we put the cake in the mouth. We're nothing until a person smiles at us, a person loves us, a person praises us, you know. It's so deep inside us. But the grossest level is just to the sensory objects. Even the grossest level is hard to control. The grossest level is hard to see. You know, the dissatisfaction, which is why we yearn for food and yearn for comfort and yearn for clothing and yearn for the warmth and the nice music and the obvious one, the sense objects. This is already so hard to see. And the absolute conviction of attachment that when I get it, I'll get happy. When I get it, it'll fill up the hole. But it's driven by this one that's so much harder to see. And that's why, if you look at the structure of the teachings, the Lam Rim, it's not even taught until the Mahayana level. So it's a more advanced level of seeing our minds that is demanded in order to really see, to hear this level of attachment, you know? Neediness, this bottomless pit of neediness, this assumption that on me here on my own am nothing. So frantic to have other people out there and all giving the positive response and the neediness to get it. I mean, if you even look at most of our relationships, once the sex has died down, you know, that type of relationship I'm talking, once that's died down, let's say, then in the end, the one that really is driving it is the attachment to reputation, is the attachment to what the other, the need to be seen by the other person, to be heard by the other person. Look at the pain and grief in most relationships. You're not heard. I'm not heard by this person. The person doesn't look at me, doesn't listen to me, doesn't respect me. This is the one of reputation. This is the one. And it seems so natural. It seems so cruel to even talk about this as if we've got a problem in wanting this, because it seems so reasonable to want this, because the entire universe is based on this. So the whole Buddhist approach, you know, Buddha doesn't own this approach of seeing your mind, but he just is very good at it, you know. His point is that who we are, what we are, everything is already in there. The potential is all there. The potential for who we are is inside us, of utter fulfillment, absolute joy, absolute bliss, absolute clarity, wisdom, compassion. All of those qualities are qualities that are existing in potential in my own mind right this second. In other words, the potential for happiness, for fulfillment. And so the schizophrenic Islam, yes, she calls it dualistic, the polite philosophical term for it, way that we are, is that we are this, like a half a person walking around waiting to find things to make me whole. You know, food, it's at the gross level, as I said, the sensory objects. But this other one is the one of the very sense of who I am. It has to be, you know, coming from the outside. Then, of course, when you're in love, because what you're getting when you're in love, not just the physical, it's this bliss of being looked at and honoured and being seen and heard. It's like a miracle for us. And we feel such joy, you know. This is where it seems so lonely in a way to hear the Buddhist view, that joy, that the joy that we can feel, or even just pleasure, happiness, there's this deep assumption we have that it is something that can only come when I get that thing out there. That's why we're junkies for the sense objects, for the praise, for the respect, all these things. Junkies for it. Because the assumption is I'm nothing until I get it. And we don't question it, because it's so primordial inside us. Therefore, of course, what it blinds us from this, from seeing, is what we think ourselves. We're too scared to do it. We want to do what they think. And so from the time we're born, we internalize God's view. It could be Buddha's view. God's view, Buddha's view, Mr. Lennon's views, Mummy's views, Daddy's views, the world's views, the Catholic nuns, everybody out there. And if we're trying to be a good person, and a good person is a person whom other people like, and we're desperate to be liked, so the good girls of the world will do everything in their power, and that's the good boys as well, everything in our power to adjust ourselves so we get the right response. We spend our lives doing this. And then when we don't, it's like hell, nightmare. We want to kill ourselves. So when a person stops liking us, we just assume, I must be bad. I did something wrong. It's so wicked. You might have, we should check. But because we're so needy for this approval, for this response from somebody, attached to what people think, to make them happy, to please them. Attachment to, the way they call it in the eight-worldly dharmas, it sounds a bit funny, you know. There's attachment to, these two particularly we're talking about here. There's one that's called attachment to praise. And then there's attachment to reputation. They seem a bit similar. But the attachment to praise is the one of attached, deeply needy to hear good words with my name in it. Hungry like a vampire to hear that. And the other one is just this attachment to being seen as a good person. So you're doing the dishes and someone comes in, like your partner comes in. You can't wait for them to see that you're doing the dishes and appreciating it. And then if they don't, look at the pain. They don't notice you're doing the dishes. It's so painful. It's so painful they didn't notice you were doing the dishes. Then you feel resentful. That's why unless we're praised and given feedback. So although another way of saying it is, of course we must do this in each other's relationships. Of course we must be loving and kind and respectful and grateful. That's different. That's practicing love. That's practicing compassion. It's our job. We're looking at the bottomless pit of neediness that feels I'm nothing unless I get it. And of course, because I'm like, I'm a bottomless pit, when you do praise me for doing the dishes, I want you to say it again. And again, and again, you know. Because we don't know how to get the nourishment from those words to nourish our own heart and to be content to do the dishes even if nobody sees me. This is very hard for us to imagine. We need to be seen to be a good girl. Desperate. And some, this is going to be the worst attachment for some of us. It's especially the attachment of good girls. What I mean by that is the bad girl. I was a bad girl. I needed people desperately to see me as well. But I was a bad girl and I was all kind of with arrogance and I was going to be a bad girl and who cares? It's like pushing people away and getting angry and being all kind of arrogant, you know. Extra painful. But in the end, we've all got that one. This one need to be seen, so desperate. Why? Because we don't think we're valid until that. Which is the tragedy of ego. This is the tragedy of ego. So therefore, not only do we not follow what we really want to do, which takes immense courage, because what if other people don't like it? It's too scary for us. So we either know what we want to do, but are too scared to do it, and then we blame other people because we think they're the ones thinking we shouldn't do it, so we blame them, you know? Because we have guilt, because our mother's a bit tough on us, and we have guilt and shame, and we're afraid to do what we want, because then we blame mummy, because she doesn't want us to do it. But I mean, nothing was stopping us. We could do it, in spite of what mummy thinks. But we're too scared. Or we're so scared to even think what we want. To even think, what do I want? Because the very next second we even begin to dare to think it, we'll say, no, that's not possible. Can't do that. They this, they that, she this, he that, it's not possible. Desperate to be a good girl, you know. And then we blame everybody else. For our own fear, for our guilt. We blame the Catholic Church or our Jewish mother or something. Are we communicating here? So we have to have the courage to start looking inside. This is the point. The thing is, even if you want to kill your father, you've got to know it. You better find out you want to kill your father. If you'll be in big trouble if you don't realise it. Next minute, the knife is in the heart. Oh, where'd that come from? Because it's repressed, you know. You don't realise you want to kill your father. So you better find out what's in there, whether it's evil like that or whether it's, you know, wanting to be a dancer. So we've got to look inside. We can't escape it. We have to look inside. And then not give up our views that we talk, you know, I was brought up a Catholic. Not give it up and then blame, which is what we tend to do, blame the Catholic Church and go against the Catholic Church. I think that's childish. Be mature, be respectful, be adult, and decide that you can make your own decisions. Thank you, God. Thank you, Catholic Church. But I'm moving in this direction now. Bye. Are we communicating? If you want to, you can say the same to Buddha. I don't mind, you know. But we want to sort of find something bad which seems to give us a reason to give up the Catholic Church or the reason to give up the husband. We have to find a bad reason. That kind of lets us off the hook, you know. But to sort of make a choice, I think I'm leaving my husband next week. You know, why? Well, I just think it's time that the relationship's over. I'm going to leave. That's too shocking in the world. We have to decide he's an evil person. You know, divorce had to be sort of finding fault once, didn't it? Had to be an intolerable relationship. You had to get off the hook. We have to find someone to blame, then I feel I'm justified in doing it. But we need to know what we want. We need to listen to what we want. And then with integrity and clarity and using wisdom and reasonableness, make our choices. Because if I don't, who will? But we love to blame. It's too painful for us to take responsibility. We really feel like as if people won't allow us. You just don't do that, you know, we think. You just shouldn't do that. You shouldn't do it. According to whom? Well, that's just the way the world is. I was taught this way, we all say. So we stay confined by that, somehow vaguely blaming, not even sure if it's God or mummy, we don't know, but it's someone out there, this they, who's forcing me not to do it. Because we're too scared to do it. Because we're too scared to do what I feel, because that won't meet with approval. It seems so simple, but it goes so deep, this one. I mean, if we just look at unhappy relationships, any kind, at work, your girlfriend, your husband, you just sort of keep going in the same relationship. Then we go home and moan about them and go back again the next day. Never, in a way, knowing we hate it. Knowing, I mean, we hate our job, we go every day. I mean, you'd think that is mental illness. But just feeling we don't have a choice. Excuse me. And then all the fear comes, well, I won't have any money, and I'll need a job, and I can't find another job, and what if this, and what if that, I couldn't do that, I'll upset my mother or my auntie, or this, whatever it might be in our life, you know. We stay paralyzed. I'm not saying we have to do anything different. But whatever it is we do, we make it our choice. A friend of mine is a Buddhist, you know, she has an alcoholic husband, a quiet alcoholic. He harms himself, you know, drinks to oblivion every night. Well, years ago, she made the decision that was good to stay in the relationship. So mostly if you have an alcoholic husband or whoever, you moan, you complain, you try to make them change, you get angry, you talk about them, you cry, you get upset, you feel frustrated, they're horrible to be around, you're not getting anything in return, they don't do anything, you go mad. Then you leave all the trauma, you know. She made a decision. So then you finally leave. Then you feel guilty, all this drama, you know. She decided she would stay. So then she became happy because she made a decision. She made her choice. And when you choose to do something, which means it's based upon what you know you want to do, then you become happy. But this vague sense of I've got to do it because they, you know, this they out there, this pressure from the outside, which is massive for most of us. And you're insane most of the time. Frustrated, annoyed, you know, blaming, guilty, all these trips. So she's happy because of it. She has her own life, she has her own thing, and she's made her choice. So choosing whatever it is you do, but making your own decision doesn't mean you have to rush off and leave something. You choose to stay in that job. You look at the good things, you realize you're getting the money, the security is there, the world's not perfect, your boss might be a creep, it's good for your practice, you're learning humility, it's what you need right now, good enough. You choose it, then your mind becomes happy. But feeling pressured into it, guilt, shame, all this nonsense, blame, this is a nightmare. This is the torture. Staying in relationships that, you know, should have that did end 20 years ago. And this is the thing about, I think, the pressure of, say, certainly being brought up, say, most of us Christians, for example, because it's seen, this marriage and relationship between two people is seen as a special thing, as a gift from God. I'm not criticizing now. And it's a sacrament, and it's for life. So this huge thing of guilt about divorce and broken relationships is very big in our minds. A big pressure, you know. Whereas as Rinpoche said, you know, the Buddhist view is karma between people. You've got a certain amount of history with each other, you come together, and some people, you can see it, well, you know, the history lasts for the 50 years. Some people, a month later, it's all over. Oh, nothing left here. Who's that bloke in my bed? Bye. A month is only a month. A pet will take a month, you know, that's it. Well, it's fine. Karma ends. It's okay. Nothing wrong with that. It's just the end of the karma. Finished. But we feel this guilt and shouldn't and what people think and the family and the worries. And it's all about what people think. Of who? Of me. Fear of reputation. Fear of people not approving of me. Terrified of it. And we don't realize the way that we really believe they think that. And we really believe it'll be a nightmare if we go against their wishes. And we give all the reasons, like we don't want to upset people, we'll say. It's all about being afraid what they think of me, disliking me, criticizing me, finding fault, attachment to reputation. Hardest one to even see, you know. And so much of the pain in our relationships is about this one. You know, you can add to it, if you look at the different delusions, the way they talk in Buddhist psychology, you know, the different neuroses, you know. There's one that's called pride. very mixed with this other one. It's one that's called pride or arrogance. And what this is this overinflated sense of yourself, which also comes with a real craving to be praised, you know, and then very offended when people don't praise you. So that seems a bit similar to this, but they're different states. And sometimes there can be a person who's very needy and always want to be approved of, but isn't very arrogant. So there's attachment, they're quite subtle. A lot of these states of mind are very, very similar. We've got to look into our minds. We've got to get some meditation. We've got to learn a bit of basic Buddhist psychology. Buddha's view is very distinct. And we've got to be able to listen to all these roommates in our head, all these different voices. They're so similar. And the ones that cause the pain, you know. They say the Buddhist approach is we really need to learn to recognize our main delusion. You know, the Buddhist model of the mind is pretty straightforward. We've got these virtuous states of mind and we have these neurotic states of mind, and they're all walking hand in hand, looking like the same half the time. It's really hard to distinguish them. You know, attachment and love can look the same, I tell you. They're completely different states of mind. One is virtuous, spacious, you know, connected to others. One is mean, frantic, needy. It looks so similar. But the thing is, we need to see which one of these neuroses, these delusions, these negative states, these neurotic states of mind are our main ones. And we've all got kind of a main... And the way to do that is to see the main way we suffer in life. So if you get upset easily and get angry easily, you know, when your attachment doesn't get what it wants, And it rises up as kind of volatile, then anger. If you get depressed easily, again, it's the same. And this is what's most fascinating. That's a similar thing, but it's internalized. Depression is simply internalized anger. It's hard to see this. It's shocking to hear this. Arrogance or pride, which we don't like to admit we have. It goes to real subtle levels. We have it desperately. And it's very similar to this attachment to what people think of me. And then when that doesn't get what it wants, it flips into low self-esteem. And look at that one we recognize. That one we recognize. I'm a creep. I'm nobody. So to recognize the main way we suffer in our life. Some of us, you know, if attachment to, say, the sensory objects like food or something is the main suffering, you know, an attachment to getting something, to say, you know, for comfort. This is the one of comfort. Okay, this is looking at this eight-body dharmas again. There's four kinds of attachment, and then there's the opposite, so it turns into eight. And there's just eight ways that attachment works, okay? So one of them is attachment to the assumption. It's the assumption that feeling good, which means being in our comfort zone, physical mostly, I'd say, is what happiness is. And that feeling not good is what suffering is. Attachment to both of these. So attachment to feel all the time being in my comfort zone, and attachment to stop being out of my comfort zone, frantic every second. So if the main one, we've all got this one hugely, we all are just junkies to be stay in our comfort zone. And I'm just talking physical here. Be comfortable, not too hot, not too cold, not too empty, not too full. The senses. And because we have such good sensory experiences in our world, not living in garbage dumps where everything is just grotesque and ugly, some people's lives, and because it's so easy for us to get sensory objects, then we're perpetually working at this one. I remember as children in our house, we were sort of poor, but also in Australia, you know, back in when I was a kid, 40s and 50s, I'd never heard of such a thing as air conditioning. We never had that. And it was just cold in the winter and hot in the summer. You just expected it. I remember we'd all have a bath would be freezing, little naked little things, freezing cold, you know, no heater. You didn't kind of complain you didn't have a heater. You didn't know about heaters. You're just cold. You kind of joked about it, you know. But now you have a mental breakdown if the heater doesn't work. I mean, you know, I was talking to Walter, why heater doesn't work in my room. You've got to fix the temperature to be the right thing. When you're in the car now, I mean, we didn't have heaters in a car. Never heard of such a thing. And now, you know, to the exact fan, to the right thing, exact degree. On one side, on the other one side, the seating is heated exactly the way I want it as opposed to... I mean, everything is so perfect for us. Everything is geared to having a perfect comfort zone, you know. And so distress and intolerance, the millisecond is not right. I remember when we had winter in Melbourne, then one time some friends of mine... doesn't matter the details, but they went to one of the fancy hotels in Melbourne. I didn't ever go to it. And some Americans were there. You know, you people. And I remember it was... it's a funny story, I'll tell you. This is me showing off now. This is me name dropping, okay? One of my friends was a close friend of one of Ray Charles's musicians. Ray Charles, the famous Ray Charles. So she wanted. So I was young and eager at 23, and she wanted me to introduce her to some of her friends. So she invited me to come to the hotel in Melbourne to hang out with Ray Charles's band, you know. So I thought I was the ant's pants, of course I did. But my main memory is because it was a winter day. I went in a winter woolly dress. Then there I am sitting in this room, and they had the heating on, of course. I'd never known the like. I was mostly just suffocating, fainting from the heat. I couldn't enjoy anything, you know. I was overwhelmed by this intense experience of being so hot. I'd never known anything like it, because I was used to being cold. Do you understand? I remember more than that, but never mind. That memory... That was a vivid memory. I'll never forget feeling so embarrassed. I was bright, red hot, and sweating, you know, this winter dress which I couldn't take off. Anyway, I remember for some reason that story. Okay. Now I'm American, so I act like an American now. Put the heater on, turn it off, the air conditioning. So attachment to just being comfortable is pretty massive, I'd say, especially when you can get what you want. You know, you can get it. You can adjust things easily. You go to Starbucks, and you know, I have, and I would order my coffee. I want a double or a triple shot. It had to be ristretto. It had to be full milk, and it had to be 180 degrees. I mean, that's like unheard of. Once you just say cup of coffee, please, and you get what you're given. You cross your fingers and hope you're the best. So this attachment, this is the one that makes you that much more easily upset the minute it doesn't come. If it comes 175 degrees, you want to sue them, you know. So staying in our comfort zone. Then the other attachment, the second pair in this eight worldly dharmas, is attachment to getting things, which is similar to the comfort one. This is really what we're talking about here. Assumption that that's happiness, and that unhappiness is when you can't or you don't. Then the last two are the ones related to the self. Attachment to hearing nice words with your name in it. Pleasant sounds, they say. And that's, we can just that one alone too, we can hear it's frantic. And then generally attaching to other people, what they think of you, you know, being approved of, jeepers maybe. And so if we see, these are attachments, but if we see all the other few variations, we get anger, you know, and anger or aversion. Aversion is the bare bones state of mind that is the response the millisecond attachment doesn't get what it wants. And so when we're not looking into our mind and living in a culture like ours and not knowing our minds, then it is bound for great stress. Because it's 1,000 times a day, the temperature won't be right, the light won't be the right colour, the coffee won't be the right taste, the cake, what you understand, the word won't be quite the right thing because we're so much more fanatic at getting it. It's much more easy to get upset when we don't get it. Because attachment's so strong. So therefore much more stress. And what else is stress, you know? Stress is the meeting point between attachment and aversion. And this is where we start to see attachment at a much subtler level. Every millisecond. We don't even know why we're stressed much of the time. We don't know why we're anxious. We don't know why we're feeling panicked, you know. We don't know why. In a moment, something passes and you feel this grip of panic. Or anxiety comes. And we're utterly unaware of what's going on in our thoughts, then it builds up and builds up until eventually you have a mental breakdown, go crazy, scream, shout, get depressed, can't get out of bed one morning. And then we have to go to the therapist and unravel it for 10 years because we didn't look when it was happening. And that's the point about seeing our minds. You know. But and that just sounds as a simple job, being your own therapist. But what goes on in this mind of ours is you know, in Buddhist psychology they say that every finger snap, there's 64 moments in a finger snap. It's like much more than, you know, those when you go running in the Olympics and you win by 1 millionth of a second and how small the pieces of seconds are now. But it's sort of like that. And every millisecond, things are happening in the mind. All just on autopilot, all just rushing, programmed. And we're not aware 99% of the time. 100% of the time in ordinary world, as Lama Zopa says, ordinary people, ordinary world, we don't even know that what goes on in here plays any role at all in our life. It's all out there. So to even begin the job of acknowledging that what goes on in your own mind is the main player is pretty stunning. Even just knowing that theoretically. You just should be, you're like, you know, you've gone to heaven, even knowing that. Then, of course, the work of doing it. It's an unbelievably hard job. But we don't have a choice, because what goes on in my mind is who I am. And I have to become who I am, and then grow who I am into what I can become, which is what Buddha says we can do, you know. Remove all the junk, become this astonishing being. So we can't escape it. And that means seeing all the rubbish in there. And owning it, not blaming mummy, daddy, you know, and the rest, which is how we crave desperately to do to get us off the hook. We have to own. This is the courage we have to have. This is what it's simply seeing our own mind. And it's very painful. I always quote, you know, a friend of mine lived years ago, went off from New York into France to one of these, you know, Tibetan retreat centres and spent a year in retreat. And she said, Robina, and she went home, and I had to go back again. I just began to see my mind. Then another year. And then another year. I just began to see my mind, she said. So it seems so hard to say, when we say, what do I want? We have no idea how to even approach it. But we've got to start with a question. Start with the recognition that I have to know my mind. Start with that. And then, you know, follow the steps. Take the steps slowly, slowly, slowly. Begin to, that's why we have to, if we like the Buddhist tools. It's not enough just to say you like Buddha. Oh, I like Einstein, he's a really nice Buddhist poster up, you know, but you never study what he says. I don't think you're going to get very far. You've got to more than just like Einstein. You've got to start studying his ideas, internalizing them, and this is the same here. And particularly we're talking about here, you know, learning the basic Buddhist approach to life, which can look so complex, but it really isn't. And the simplest way, the very first step, is just to control our body and speech, behave nicely, don't shoot the mouth off every day, you know, because that's going to harm others. But basically what it does is stir up the rubbish in our own mind, making life even worse. So control our body and speech, get a bit of discipline, then learn to be our own therapist, as Lama Yeshe nicely puts it, which is where you really become a Buddhist. But to do that, you've got to understand, at least theoretically, Buddha's view of the mind, which is very different, as we know, from the Western view. We're not saying you've got to go look at your brain. You can do that if you wish, but that's not what's discussed here. You've got to looking at your mind means listening to your thoughts. Listening. And then it's not enough just to listen. You've got to know how to label what you're hearing. And this is where Buddha's very distinct model of the mind comes in. So as we all know, he talks about the root delusion, the mother of them all, the main source of all pain, period, is this mistaken sense of self. And this is the subtlest one. If this attachment is so hard to see, forget about this one. But at least we know it theoretically, this misconception of a self, this independent sense of a separate, lonely, bereft, concrete self. On the basis of that, there's this bottomless pit of attachment to get what that self wants. And this is hard enough to see. Effectively, in the Four Noble Truths, Buddha is saying, attachment is the main cause of suffering. Ignorance is the one, this ego grasping one, the root. But effectively, in day-to-day life, attachment is the main one. And don't underestimate it. It's such a simple word, but it goes to such subtle levels, like we're talking about. And this one, it seems to me, my way of putting it, this one attachment to nice words, to be seen as good, all this business, the attachment to reputation, what they're saying, and praise, is the closest you can get to the root delusion of the neurotic self. It's so linked to that one. And what's utterly interesting to hear in Buddha's view, which you only learn when you learn Buddhist psychology, what we're discussing right now is Buddhist psychology, is that this feeling we have, which we know about so strongly, this terrible feeling of dissatisfaction, always wanting something more, never satisfied, distressed, thinking, addicted to feeling I'm a terrible person. That is what dissatisfaction is, and it is the consequence of attachment. It's a product of attachment, never being satisfied. And of course, because all these feelings, as we call them, are so deeply ingrained, we assume that they're the truth about me. So we feel like I'm nothing. We believe I'm nothing. This is the part that's the worst. You know? When someone else criticizes us, for example, or turns against us or stops loving us, either, you know, one response in a certain kind of person with a lot of anger could be to rage against that person. Like I'm reading Frank Sinatra's biography at the moment. And he's renowned for his rage, unbelievable rage. I mean, throwing things, smashing things, smashing people, shooting people, unbelievable rage. The millisecond he didn't get what he wanted. Rage like you can't imagine. Nearly kill people with his rage. Shocking. And you hear it. And all you can hear, of course, is this, if you're using this model of the mind, Buddha's view of attachment and how these things work and how aversion or anger is the response when attachment doesn't get what it wants, you know. So the millisecond he would hear an unhappy word, a person would leave him, you know, because he would just, this nightmare would occur. So then you could also see he had this self-loathing. But when you see a person who's angry, you don't notice how they're angry. You don't notice their own aversion for themselves. It's mostly the aversion to other people. It's the most obvious, isn't it? But some people, as we know, won't hit it out on other people. It just goes straight in. So that with him is already there. You can see anybody who hates other people, what does that mean? That means anger is in their mind, right? And if anger's in your mind, you can't like yourself. You couldn't be a content person, could you? It's sort of obvious. So it has to also be for yourself. But when it's for other people, we can't see it's also for yourself. In other words, he was had so much attachment. I'm just using him as an example. He's just like the rest of us. For what other people thought of him. It had to be, he was like this junkie, you know, for praise. And he could have got it to the world level. Junkie for praise. And would manipulate like a vampire, it seems. You know, it's the way, I'm just poor old Frank. I like Frank Sinatra. I love listening to Frank Sinatra. He's great, got a great voice. But it's just like a workshop on the mind, reading about it. It's just some grips me completely, you know. Mostly with a person like that, all you see is the anger and you're naughty, you know, how dare, bad, bad, bad. But it's obviously a symptom of his own incredible self-loathing. It has to be. It's logical. How could it? It's not possible to be content with yourself and not like other people. It's completely impossible. Utterly impossible. Because he so desperately needed other people to praise him. Which means he has this bottomless pit of attachment, which means he's got this bottomless pit of dissatisfaction. To anger is the response when it doesn't get what it wants. Now, some people, look at Marilyn Monroe. Different. She didn't go around bashing people. She just bashed herself. He bashed himself and other people. Can you see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. She didn't have that tendency. She was also this bottomless pit for approval, mm-hmm. praise. She was brilliant at what she did, just like he was. She was adored, just like he was. But when she was never satisfied with it, like he wasn't, she turned against herself. You see what I'm saying, people? So it's all the same disease. But she just harmed herself. Well, she also was very rude up here, arrogant and messed up and didn't go in time to all the things. And it's just the same as Frank. I tell you, they're fast gripping me. I've got Frank Sinatra, Barron's biography I'm reading. Also, who else? I'm reading many people at the moment. I love these people. Well, I've read all the jazz musicians recently too. I'm reading three biographies at the one. This is a couple of weeks ago. Before I came to Boston and finished. Charlie Parker, Duke Ellington and Billy Strayhorn together. I was immersed, you know. We go to YouTube and hear their things and go back to the biography, you know. All on my iPad, of course. But it's like a workshop in the mind. I mean, it's like a complete, vivid workshop in the mind. And this is what I find very interesting about Buddhist psychology. Because we're so used to believing in the West that a person is made by their parents, so we always have to keep going back to see what mummy's, you know, Frank's mummy did to her, and Frank's daddy, and Frank's this. You understand? But I have no interest in that. I want to see Frank's mind, thank you. That's more than enough to understand Frank. Attachment, aversion, arrogance, you know, attachment, anger, arrogance, jealousy. You look at these four, I swear, you can understand a person. I'm not trying to be simplistic here. This is the Buddhist approach, you know. It's deceptively simple. We think it's so complex in the West. So we have to, if we want to apply the Buddhist tools, is one of my points here. You can study Jung, you can study Freud, you can do all that. If you want, you can be a neuroscientist, really, do it, nothing wrong. But if you want to apply the Buddhist tools the way I'm talking, you need to study Buddha's view, which is this very specific one. It's mind, not physical, not your brain. It's your own qualities. It didn't come from your parents. Mummy and Daddy did certain things. They do play a role. But they didn't give you your mind. Frank got born with his dissatisfaction. He got born with his arrogance. He got born with his jealousy. They were his tendencies that he brought with him. So powerful, this point. So it's the idea of karma, and it sounds nice theory, but it's got profound, marvellous experiential implications. Because it means it's mine. And it's my baby. I had better know it. I had better start finding the tools to look inside and identifying. And what that means, not identifying which cell is working, not getting your microscope onto the brain, listening to your thoughts, your feelings, unpacking them, listening, unraveling them, hearing the elaborate cognitive stories that they all are. This is, you know, the neurotherapist. So someone like Frank with the anger plus arrogance. Anger and arrogance go hand in hand, you know. Never, he was renowned, everybody always said it, ever thought he was wrong. Always somebody else's mistake. Every time. That's arrogance. That is, I mean, and this is the interesting point when you see it. As Buddha says, fear, you see, in interesting Buddhist psychology, fear is not given its own status as a particular delusion. I'll tell you why. Because all the delusions are in the nature of fear. Fear is their nature. As Lama Zopa says, when you've rid the mind of all delusions, when you've realized emptiness, there is no fear. There is only bliss. Don't hear that as religious. It's a fact, psychological. Fear is that. So he lived, in other words, he lived in hell. His mind was in hell 99% of the time. Hell. Always surrounded by, it was desperate to be surrounded by other people. Could never be alone. Ever be alone, frantic for other people. All his, you know, his mafia friends, all his gangster friends, all these people supporting him and craving and patting his back and giving him whatever he wanted. People terrified of him. He lived in hell, never knowing really what he wanted, never knowing his own mind, never taking responsibility. I mean, I'm just using him as an example. I'm not trying to go against Frank Sinatra. It's okay, you know. So to me, it's like reading a psychological workshop, reading the biographies of these people. It helps me understand people's minds, you know. Therefore my mind, because there's nothing in him I don't recognize. For me, this is the most powerful thing, learning about your own mind. When you read other people, instead of, oh my God, look at Frank's life, he's terrible anger, how shocking. No. All I've got to go to say to myself is, thank you, Frank, for showing me my mind. Or I say to myself, I recognize that. That is powerful for your own mind. Lived in hell. Maramano lived in hell. bottomless pit of attachment to be seen by others. And the more she got, as my mother used to say, the more you get, the more you want. This is the nightmare of attachment. Until eventually she couldn't stand it and killed herself. I mean, talk about suffering. The inner prison, as mothers ever talked about. When, you know, I always quote that story. This young Mexican prisoner who first wrote to us, 18 years old, living in this small cell, smaller than, you know, about the size of one of those bathrooms here, these toilets, 23 hours a day. Mm. Noise like you couldn't imagine. Mm. The inside of a pen, a few books, that's it. Many people, thousands living in cells like that, with another person. You know, air conditioning, light and noise like you can't believe. Like being in a rock concert all day, they say. So Rumiche, when this young man wrote to Rumiche, he said, your prison is nothing in comparison with the inner prison of ordinary people. Prison of attachment, prison of anger, prison of arrogance, prison of low self-esteem. The prison of the ignorance that doesn't see that my suffering comes from my own mind. That's the worst. Bad enough, as Lama Zopa says, that the world appears to us the way it does. Ugly, beautiful, jealous, angry, gorgeous, this, that, this, blah, whatever it is, you know. Bad enough that the world appears to us like that. Bad enough that I appear to myself in the way I think I exist. But the worst thing is that I think that's true. So at least to have the thought that maybe things appear this way when you're in the midst of your anger, in the midst of your low self-esteem, in the midst of your depression. At least to think maybe things don't exist the way I think they do. Maybe things don't exist the way they appear to me. Because this is the tragedy, the Buddha says, happens. Because of this addiction, these delusions we get born with, programmed with them, from the first second of conception. That as they say in Buddhist psychology, everything appears to us, everything out there, people, things, events, you know, everything appears out there, including yourself. Everything appears out there in the aspect of what is in your mind. So beginning even to know that theoretically is mind-blowing. It completely reverses everything. Because the whole point of all suffering, as Buddha says, is we think it's out there from its own side as it appears to us. That's how it is. And there's this constant schizophrenic, dualistic, as they politely call it, division between me and everything else, you know. So we have no choice but to look into our own minds. Even knowing theoretically, what, you know, giving it a go, this approach of the Buddha's, that what happens in here is the main source of my happiness and suffering. Forget even karma, you know. Forget even whether you like the idea of past lives, future lives, which is a subtler view of Buddha's, which explains even why we meet this stuff in the first place. And even why it appears to us in this way or that. And why people harm and why people don't. That karma explains that. But forget even that. Just to know that your attachment, your fears, your neediness, your anger, your resentment, your jealousy, your low self-esteem, your rage, whatever, that they are causing the people and things and events and cakes and friends to look the way they look. You know. So if I change this, this will appear differently. It's such a simple concept, but it's utterly opposite to what we instinctively feel is true. So we have to look inside. We have to know what we want, because I'm the boss of my life, no one else. It doesn't, and it sounds, when you say it this way, it sounds selfish, which is the big one that the good girls and good boys don't want to be, more than anything, because we're desperate to be seen as good people. So we'll do anything but appear to be selfish. Because you can't criticize a person for being kind, you know. So Ellen says, we've got to have the courage to know that maybe it's right. And that, and okay, so the next point is, how do I know what's right? This is the point, isn't it?
Right.
I'll tell you how. It's not complicated. It just takes time, that's all. So using this nice analogy that I use all the time, and this, you know, this analogy, the Buddha says a bird needs two wings, wisdom and compassion. All the Buddhist path, actually, all this lam rim, is a way of structuring it, is in terms of the two wings. The first two scopes of practice, which are all about controlling your body, speech and mind, knowing you, understanding karma, knowing your mind, do all the stuff we're talking about right now. This is the wisdom wing. This is the inner work. This is sorting out you. Knowing your mind, controlling your body, your speech, doing this radical changes of your being. That's the wisdom wing. So wisdom wing, why? Why is it called wisdom? Well, it's sort of not rocket science. We all can see. The more I'm caught up in my own neuroses and my own fears and dramas, the less I can see past my own nose. Because I'm seeing everything through the filter of my, you know, I'm seeing everything. It appears to me through what I'm thinking. So there's no wisdom. Wisdom means being clear about how things are. So that relationship, everybody else can see, it's a nightmare. Everyone else can see you're scratching each other's backs and the karma's over and you're just manipulating each other, trying to be pretending to be still such harmonious. But it's finished. There's finish between you. Everybody else can see it maybe, but you're as blind as a bat. So fearful, you know, worried about security, desperately thinking I'm wrong, I shouldn't want a divorce, I shouldn't learn, only I do this and do that, maybe he'll still love me, and then for a year living in this nightmare, or just the complacency of thinking I don't have a choice. That's ignorance. That's terrible ignorance. For all the fears of making your own decisions, you know, putting up with garbage, just dying in yourself because of fears and all this nonsense. That's ignorance. Very simple. And the other one is compassion, of course, and that's more profound. And it's on the basis of wisdom that you can actually have proper compassion. So right now when there's no wisdom, which means there's lots of attachment and neediness and I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine, and then anger and jealousy and resentful and blame and manipulating and guilt and all the junk that we know about, which is the opposite to wisdom. If we have this, plus, fortunately, we do have some compassion in love and love in the mix. We've not just only got the delusions, we'd be a nightmare if we did. But like with Frank, who was enormously generous and very loving and many times, you know, it's obvious, completely polluted by attachment to who he thought he was and other people seeing him in a certain way. So better than nothing that you're kind to somebody, but, you know, maybe we're not Frank with the dollars that Frank had. But we're so desperate to be seen as good that we are compassionate. That compassion is still good. But it's completely polluted by our own neediness, our own fears and everything, you know. So that's why I say it's hard to criticize compassion. But when it's all mixed with attachment, it's really a mess. So the moment we do have compassion, so what we're trying to do is get the wisdom first. Get rid of the fears and the dramas and the ego grasping and have the courage to follow our own convictions and be clear and make our choices. Then our compassion is really genuine. Compassion is not enough, as His Holiness says. You've got to have wisdom. Or as Lama Zopa says, meaning well is not enough. You've got to have wisdom. So, okay. So it seems to me if we take this analogy of the bird needs two wings, it really works if you think, well, what's the, you know, because, okay, so what'll I do, we'll think. I don't know. What do you want? I don't know. What's the right thing to do? I don't know. We mostly don't know. And I'll tell you why, is because we don't have a sound basis for making our decisions. Most of the time we make our decisions is attachment. Like I see it reading Frank, it's so naked. The way he married this person, out of resentment, what other person thinks. He when he was raging jealous about Ava Gardner because she was off sleeping with somebody else, he went and married someone else, you know. I mean, it was looking like it was kind and loving, and the girl probably thought he loved her. But you can see that all the decisions were completely polluted by his attachment. You see what I'm saying? So it's just a complete nightmare from pillar to post, insanity. Almost nothing was authentic. I'm not trying to put him down. It was like, forget his name. I shouldn't have told you his name. I said, this person I'm reading about, I shouldn't have told you, you know. So I love Frank Sinatra. He's a great musician. It's just this workshop. I can't believe this. This stunning. I can't wait to read it, you know. This latest, oh my God, you see, you try to learn about, it's like studying a brain. If you're a neuroscientist, you're dying to look at it, study more about the diseases, or you're dying to get the cancer under the microscope, you know, so you can study it more. That's the reason for me. It's just so helpful to see the mind and to see the suffering. So, if you have as a basis for you, okay, so right now most of us follow the basis for our decisions is attachment. If it feels good, we'll do it. If people will love us for it, we'll do it. If they think it's a good thing, we'll do it. If it looks like I'm being a good person, we'll do it. You kind of hear what I'm saying? I know, of course, not totally, but this is when we make a mess of our decisions. This is when we make a mess of our decisions. Our decisions end up being wrong because the basis was wrong. So, what basis instead? Wisdom and compassion. So how would it sound for the wisdom one, which is the lesser one, but it's where most of us are at, and we can still use the other one, which is profound, I'll tell you. So the wisdom one would be like this. You'd go, you're in a job, or you're in a relationship, you know, or any kind. Or you're going to go to a movie with somebody. Anything, the smallest decision you want to make. You've got to do what is most beneficial every time. As His Holiness says, always aspire to do what is most beneficial. If you can, long-term better than short-term. So beneficial has different degrees. So the first one will be the wisdom wing. So you say to yourself, you know, normal reason for taking a job, normal basis for the decision is if it's in the particular area you like, you know, good for your career. I'm not criticizing that, I'm just looking. Or it could be it's close to home, or it could be the top dollar, you know. So if you're clear about the basis for your decision is always whether it's the top pay, well, that's easy to find the job, isn't it? You know, oh, there's the right job, biggest number of dollars. Okay, get it. No problem. You're really clear. So here the basis is wisdom, let's say. What does that mean? That means this is how it would sound. Okay, let's say I've got a job. Is my status, let's say I'm annoyed with my boss, you know, but I'm doing other things. It's good, it's my career, blah, blah, blah. But the boss is really mean, let's say. So I say to myself, will my staying in this job help me learn more patience, more patience, less in attachment, be more brave in the face of accept criticism, for example, which is wisdom wing work, and you say, yep, well then it's the right job. That's the right thing to do. So okay, it is still more subtle than that. There are other things you have to factor in. Because if the job is paying so little and you're not paying enough for your rent, then clearly it's a no-brainer. Leave the job. But that's the point. If it's the best job and you love it and your boss adores you, but you're not getting enough pay, then you'd feel hard to leave because it's easy. And that's the attachment to our comfort zone. As long as everything's easy, we think it's good because we're junkies for good feelings. So in other words here, just because it's not a good feeling doesn't mean it's not the right thing to do. And just because it's got a good feeling doesn't mean it's the right thing to do. So you think, will this help me lessen attachment and lessen anger and lessen pride? And if the answer is yes and there's no other obvious option, you'll go, okay, I'm happy, I'll do this job. And you keep on moving with a happy mind. You make it your choice. And if every day you're working on yourself, and every day you're doing some practice, and every day you are aspiring, may I do what's most beneficial, then one day you'll wake up and you'll see another job, which is a perfect opportunity. You say, bye, time to go. It will be the right thing to do. Instead of running off following attachment every second, which gets you lost. It's like for me, you're walking on a road, and the road is your life. So it's the right road. And because potholes come, we get all upset, so we take a side turn where there are no potholes. Then you get lost, because it's the wrong turn off. It's your pothole, baby. Own it. Deal with it. Climb over the obstacle. Keep moving. Straight and narrow. May I do what's most beneficial? And if it really right now means do what is best to help me develop my qualities, that will mean you'll give up that relationship. That will mean you'll even leave your children, if it's the most beneficial thing. That will be horrifying in the world. Everybody will jump on you. But if you know it is the best thing to go off for a month to do that retreat to help you become a better person, not just attached to doing it, but knowing it's the right thing for you at this particular time in your development, then you will do it. So having the courage to make decisions that, you know, aren't comfortable and aren't based on attachment. Then you've got the compassion wing. So my friend, maybe the Buddhist one, you know, I'm not trying to say she's so noble, but she felt it was, you know, that she had this connection with this person. The karma's not over, maybe you can say it like that. There's nothing in the relationship for her. You could say this. It's alcoholic, you know. But she made a decision. And it got best of both worlds because it helped her practice and it was beneficial to others. Will it help not only herself, but him as well? So she did it. So it was the right choice. And when it's the right choice, she had a happy mind. She dealt with deals with the obstacles. So will my doing... Okay, a simple example. Your girlfriend rings you up and you're tired. And she just wants to talk to you. But you can tell she's just bored, you know. She's sort of just... It's just gossip. Not being unkind, but it's a tough decision to make. You know, not even if you're not tired, but, you know, she wants this rabbit on. And you can hear it, she's just misusing, and she's just following attachment. Not being rude, but we need to see each other's minds. And you say, sweetheart, I'm really tired, and I've got to go to sleep now. See you later, bye. But not worried about what she'll think of you, because she might get upset. But you know it's the right thing for her. Another time, someone might want to take you out for a movie, and you're really exhausted. But you know they need to talk, they need to be with you. They're lonely, they're depressed, they're sad, and it'd be really good for them if you went. You decide, I will go. And then you make it your choice. You don't go resentfully and then moan the next day to your other friends about it. You make it your decision, and it was for the sake of others, even though you didn't want it. We have to be this way. Otherwise we're just junkies following our feelings. This is a total, utter nightmare, which has got us lost until we are now, following what we think are our feelings, which are 99% of the time attachment. If it feels good, it must be good, you know. But it's not true. And you can only do this if you begin to notice your mind and have this wish, I want to do what's most beneficial. May I do what's most beneficial? Of course we don't know what is most beneficial, but having the aspiration every day, may I do what's most beneficial, because every thought counts, it sows a seed in your mind. And maybe not only that, but it nourishes the seeds that you've already planted in the past. And it will nourish the very seeds that will manifest as the very thing that will be the most beneficial when the time is right. Meanwhile, get up every day, put one foot in front of the other, and lead your life with a happy mind, dealing with the obstacles that arise, because, baby, they're your obstacles. This way you lead life well. But the key to it is beginning to look inside you. And having the courage to make the tough choices, based on wisdom or compassion. And wisdom is what if it lessens your neuroses. Compassion is if it helps you, you know. Also lessen your neuroses, it's the same. Going to the movie with a friend and you're tired lessens your neuroses for sure, but it's an action of generosity to her. Whereas the other one is an action of kindness to her by saying, no, I'm busy, good night. Rather than worrying what she'll think and at the same time being resentful while she's on the phone and then criticizing it to other people, which is what we do. Because we're too scared to make our own proper choices. We always want to blame other people. Or, you know, like I said, do the Marilyn and turn it against ourselves. So do you have any questions about this business? Yes.
I'm thinking of what you said about how important it is for us to feel seen by other people.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking about babies and deprived of that mirroring from the mother.
Yeah, that's right.
So
you see, there's virtue and there's not. We're talking virtue here because we are social beings, aren't we? We're born from mothers. And the baby, you can see it, they learn everything they've ever known from seeing the mother. So that's just common sense. That's reasonable. And so therefore the mother has a job to always appear the most perfect for that baby. Not vomit her own junk on the baby, but give everything that helps that baby. And when that baby is nourished by this, they can then begin to make their choices, you know. So this is obvious. This is called love. And this is the compassion wing. That's the compassion wing. So here we're talking about from our point of view of the bottomless pit of misery. And even if our mummy and daddy have given us lots of love, We can see this. Some people, okay, I can think of a person, there's one person I'm thinking of now, who had a really brutal father. Brutal, mean, arrogant, always criticized. But this boy, because he had a lot of compassion in his own mind, okay, he was dying for daddy to approve of him. But he had a lot of compassion and therefore wisdom, and then he was able to grow himself very easily out of this and even look back and see his father with compassion. It didn't disturb him much because he had his own resources. But another child who's a bottomless pit of neediness and resentful and bitter can have a dear, kind mother. But no matter what she does, he's always going to moan and complain because he doesn't know how to even get the nourishment from what he was given. So it's not just simple of they like this because you didn't get enough from your mother, which is our typical view. It's not that. The first thing to look at is what's in the mind of the person. But of course, from the point of view of being a mother, this is absolutely clear. Your job is to completely give everything, to show perfect example to this baby. But then depending on whether, you know, Hitler was a baby once. And Hitler had his own neuroses. So whatever his mummy showed him, if he was completely insane and, you know, psychotic, which he must have been, excuse me, he'll take what he's, in his own twisted way, he will get from this. So it's you understand, well, as soon as we factor in that the person has, that the baby has their own mind, then it's comfortable. We can understand what's going on. But the mother, of course, must pay attention. And this is something I was talking about in the group when we were in Maine. One person asked about her children. And this is something I really think a lot about my own family, the 7 kids. And my mother was an amazing mother, but full of depression and fears and worries and her own drama with her husband and all the nonsense that happened in the family. And so common among families is that we happen to be 7 of us. We happen to be poor. We never have enough rooms. Forget about beds. So we used to share beds. And so there were these 7 human beings in this already chaotic family with an alcoholic father and other dramas going on, and my mother and father were their dramas. I mean, there was this atomic bomb every day of emotion. But of course, because we were all children, the children are they're like seen as this big lump. Oh, there's the children. No one ever paid attention to any one of us individually. The only time my mother paid attention to me was when I was really naughty and vomited everywhere and smashed things, and then she fixed me up and cleaned me and stroked me to sleep. And I remember, never forget the stroke on my forehead, you know. My mummy was hearing me, loving me. I'll never forget those moments. But most of the time you couldn't. There she was. My father's an alcoholic. He spent the money, didn't make it. She never had enough money. She even paid, I think she still owes the Catholic convent the bills for the education, you know. She sent us to the fanciest convent in Melbourne. And she was always, you know, struggling to stay alive and to do it. So she didn't have the mental time to give individual time to her 7 children, who are 7 different people. But we just, and so then what we did, each of us in our own crazy way, was respond to this crazy chaos. And you felt over, my main experience as a child, it's not blaming anybody, my own nature, I felt completely like I was drowning. And that, you know, and you can't, and it's like you're squeezed up with everybody and everything. So there's anger and violence and jealousy. I was a bully. I'd beat the kids and mean because I just had no space. And you didn't know you were missing it. You didn't know you were missing it. I didn't know I wasn't being heard. I didn't know. You're just like living in this chaos. And I love my mother and father. I love my family. Me and my siblings now are the best of friends. It's just my own. It's just characterizing some of my feelings. Okay, so the second I went to boarding school, I was in heaven because I had space. I had my own bed. I had sanity. I went to mass every morning. I was, you know, very holy. I was naughty but holy inside. And I went to mass every morning. I was in total bliss. I studied for the first time. I tasted my own potential for the first time because I had space. So the mind is everything, but conditions are so huge. This is the way Buddhism would work. In our culture, we think it's all the conditions and you're a product only of your conditions. But the Buddha says the mind is actually the main thing, but it's fed by the conditions. So the moment I had sane conditions, then I began to flourish. Do you understand what I'm saying? And so then even this mother, we're talking about she's got 3 kids, and then because it's cold and not enough money to save money, they close the children's bedroom doors and they all live in this one little room together. I said, do you ever spend any individual time with them? And she said, no. I said, and I talked about this one, and I think it's very powerful. Every individual being, as a child, you need your mother like you need light, like you need air. You've got, and everything you'll learn is from her. And this is the point. Also, so we all say, how can I be a better mother? What can I do to understand my children? Well, the first step is put yourself together. Because if you haven't done the wisdom wing, excuse me, you're going to make a mess, you know. You've got to know your own mind. Then you can afford to do this job of in each little human being nourishing, growing them up. You know, then they do their own trip and have some sanity. And this is the point about the power in the virtuous way of hearing other people, acknowledging other people. If you're a child and someone's listening to you, because you need to have mummy to listen to you. That's how you begin to grow up and even know you're a separate person. So mummy must acknowledge everything you say, and she must listen carefully. Then you learn, if you've got some sense, you will learn deeply to be heard, and then you can hear yourself more easily. But if no one's heard you in the first place, and you don't know how to hear yourself, then you're just lost. Do you see what I mean?
Right.
So parents, of course, my God. But this is a virtuous way of putting it. People are looking at the neediness from our side. And this is where the mother one, you know, we talk about, just joking today about Italian mothers and their Italian children. Where some mothers do whatever their children want. Well, I mean, guess what you're going to get? These 40-year-old infants, you know, the 40 and 50-year-old infants who never grow up because mummy still does their washing and still makes their bed and still does cooks for them and thinking it's called love. I mean, it's the most gross and obvious misunderstanding of what love and attachment is. You know? And this is the attachment I'm talking about, afraid of upsetting people. And thinking that being kind to people is good. Whereas if it's mixed with attachment, it's like I said, it's very hard to criticize that, a kindness action. If the mother beat them up, you can criticize her. So that's compassion with wisdom, not with attachment. And then it can be tough love. You know? So it's a huge one. Sounds easy, but it's a tough job. It starts with knowing your own mind. No shortcut. Someone else? What do you say? Questions? Any questions? Anything? Yes?
I was just wondering, do you think that we're wired with this need for approval? Like
so when you say wired, what do you mean?
We come into the world that way.
That's right. So where do you come from in the world? What's your view? Where do you come from? Just roughly so I can answer your question according to your view. What's your view? Where do you come from? Whose wiring are you getting? What's your view? Out of interest.
With no disrespect, mine would be Father God.
Okay, fine. Okay. Would be who?
Father God.
Well, then so you're blaming God for your neuroses? That's a bit rude, isn't it? You can't blame God for your bad things, can you?
No.
Well, then what do you think? What do you think then? If you that's fine. If you have the view of a creator, so then your question is a bit of a dilemma question, because if you really have the view of a creator, then why are you asking if we come wired with negativity? Because you can't blame God for that, can you? Do you blame God for your negativity? Or have you got a doubt about that? Is that what you're saying, really?
It's more like, if Father God made me this way,
that's right.
There must be some good in the need for approval.
Okay, you know, okay. So now I hear what you're saying. So there's
might
two...
might not all be negative.
No, I know. What's your name?
Michael.
Michael. So, Michael, let me make this distinction here, which is really the point in Buddhist psychology. There's two things, like I'm talking about the child here. The need for approval, by using that word in particular, meaning attachment, and attachment is this terrible, bottomless pit of kind of neurotic neediness, not healthy. So, of course, on a conventional sense, a valid need to be seen, like I'm talking about the child, that's called virtuous. Buddha talks about non-virtuous and virtuous, or negative and positive states of mind. And the one we're particularly talking about here, based, of course, on the Buddha's view of the mind, which is you do come wired, but obviously not from a creator. That's just the Buddha's view. You come wired with your own stuff from the past. And what he says is we need to look into the stuff that's called neurotic, because that's what causes us pain and causes us to harm others. So then your model is a very different model. You know? So do you accept that we do have negative wiring? And where do you think it comes from if you have a faith in God? What's your view? Why, you know, Hitler made God too, right? God made Hitler too, right? So why Hitler, or why naughty children, why psychos, why multi-murderers? Do you have an answer to that, or are you still looking into it? Will you have confidence that you have a view about it?
Well, I think the nicest thing that another human being can say to another human being is hi.
Answer my question.
Well, that...
Does that answer my question where Hitler came from? Say hi. I'm just interested in your view.
No, but I think that, you know, that's not necessarily always a bad thing.
What? Which one?
I mean, if I say hi, I just...
I'm talking about Hitler, darling. Michael, can you get to my question?
Oh.
I think what you're saying is amazing. Saying hi to everybody, I love that. But do you have an... I'm just curious. I'm not trying to debate or anything. I'm just curious if you do have an answer to where negative wiring comes from. Do you accept that some people do bad things to each other? Do you accept that? In the world, darling. Do you accept that some people do bad things to each other in this earth? You don't accept that.
I don't know the answer to that.
No, that's what I'm asking. I was just asking you. I'm not trying to be mean. I was just asking.
No, I know you.
That's okay. Thank you, Michael. I just wanted to know what you thought. Thank you very much. I understand. Thank you. Someone else? Yes.
I got caught off guard there for a second. Okay, so you say listen to your mind and label the thoughts inside of it. So what do I do once I label those thoughts? Mm-hmm. So I feel very attached to whatever my parents' happiness.
Right. So what do you do? Okay, if you're learning to be a botanist, and you have to learn to distinguish a weed from a flower, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
So your question is, well, what do I do when I learn to identify a weed? What would your question be? What would your answer be? What would you say then?
I yank it out.
Yeah, so you have to have the view. You have to have an assumption here that a weed is a thing that's going to, you know, mess up your garden.
Right.
So that you have to have an assumption here that a negative state of mind is one that causes you suffering and causes you to harm others. That's the assumption behind it, is it not?
No, it is.
So then surely, once you've established there's something in your mind that you can see is neurotic, and darling, join the club. The Buddha says we're riddled with them, and it's a while to go, but this is what the job is, to start to identify them. Then you've got to listen to it carefully and hear it. And then you have to ask yourself, do I want this in my garden? I mean, it sounds pretty simple to say it this way. So the assumption is you have to see it as something that will harm you and then slowly aspire to change it. What else can you do? You can't do it overnight. But what else would you do? What would you suggest?
Well, I think about my relationship with my parents.
Uh-huh.
And I think about how much of myself I've given to them.
Uh-huh.
And I don't like that. It doesn't make me feel good.
Oh, sorry. Stop right there. What do you say?
So I do what my parents want me to do, and it's not often what I want.
You said
to
you
do.
Give what yourself to your parents. So you do what they want.
Right.
Okay, I see. So you see this, what we're discussing in here, and you feel it maybe it's not what you really think you should be doing.
And
is
so,
that
yes.
You're feeling a bit of tension there, isn't it?
I feel a bit of tension, yes.
Okay, good. So then go on.
And so I think about, well, okay, there's my... I have that thought,
sure.
And I'm afraid of hurting them.
Okay, good. And now stop right there. Stop. So this is where the analysis has to come. That's where the analysis has to come. And I know it sounds a bit simple and clinical, but let's use this as a simple example of what is the next step, which is what you just asked me, yeah?
Well, then I guess what you've been saying in this mm-hmm. talk is the next step is I see a choice.
You see a choice, that's right, darling, and you do it and you have a choice. And this is, it takes time, but you either decide you're going to do whatever you feel your parents want because you don't want to upset them. And that sounds very noble, but that means you've got to make this dramatic choice to give up wanting what you want. Just like I talked about that meditator living with his old auntie.
Right.
Obviously he got to the point where he was anyway so fulfilled internally, he was easily able to sacrifice his life. But meanwhile, he was fulfilling himself anyway in his meditation, but he was sacrificing his life for his old auntie. And most of us aren't at that point to fully sacrifice what we feel. If you don't have a choice, then fine. So that's the choice, but the trouble is we don't make that choice. We sit there and we have this conflict of, I wish I could do this, but I don't want to upset them. And then we get angry and then we go crazy. And this is how we live our lives, and we've got to make some choices. And see, this is the other point to make to you. When you understand that, let's say your mummy and daddy, let's say they're normal people like the rest of us, they've also got attachment, and they've got masses of attachment to their darling daughter, and that means they want their darling daughter, their attachment is attached to their darling daughter to do what they want, and that, so when you understand that in your own mind, you understand it in theirs, and then when you see your own mind and you realize that attachment is a bottomless pit, that the more food you eat, the more hungry you get, the more craving you get. So the more you think you're giving somebody what they want, but because of their own attachment, they will continue to want more, then it will never, ever, 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 ever satisfy them. This is the thing with us all with reading about poor old Frank Sinatra, because he had this massive attachment to get what he wanted. No matter what people did, they craved, they prostrated in front, they gave him everything, it still didn't work because he had this, he didn't know how to, attachment can never be satisfied, it's a disease. And that, so when you have the courage to realize, it is marvelous to want to make your family happy. This is huge. This is called compassion. But you could say that it's not your job to make them happy. To do what you can to make them happy. But if it's true that you're a human being, you have a right, you have some things to accomplish, that's what human beings do, then you make those choices. And then you love your mummy and daddy regardless and have the courage to allow them to get upset if they choose to get upset. But that's what terrifies us. We're terrified of, but actually what terrifies us is not that they're getting upset, but is that they're rejecting us. That we're not getting them to continue to love us. And that is what is like a nightmare to us. And it's very hard to see, and we need much courage, you know.
Is it okay to label label a thought as fear?
Of course, they're all fear. Of course it's fear. It's masses of fear.
But then validate that and say, yes, I am afraid. I have every right to be afraid. Or should I say that's a delusion?
No, it is a delusion, but then be gentle with yourself and go according to your capacity. You've got to recognize it's a weed, whether it's too big for you to pull out right now, but you've got to know it's a weed. And because fear is only painful. But we've got to take it at our own pace. We can't, because we see it's a weed, doesn't mean I should pull it out now. But it's too big, it's too deep, it's too instinctive. But we've got to start this process of being clinically clear, and that takes time, distinguishing between the valid, virtuous, positive voices and the neurotic, fear-based voices. And this is the scary part. But we have to live with those fear-based voices for quite a while, because they're going to be a while before they go. But the first step is to begin to see them all, hear them all. They all look like triple twins right now. All your roommates in your head all look like we're just confused. You've got to start identifying. There's anger, there's jealousy, there's attachment, there's fear. That's cool. You're going to be here for a while, but I'll live with you. Not resist them. But we've got to start recognizing them first, and the troublemakers, and you'll treat them respectfully. And then you'll let the virtues come out, and the courage and the bravery, and yes, Mum, no, I've decided I'm not going to do that one after all, Mum. I'm going to go on a holiday in Italy for a month, but I'm going to give up my career at university, and I'll pay my debts later. It's okay. And she'll have a mental breakdown, and you'll be having a mental breakdown about her mental breakdown. But, this is why people can't, that's why even with Frankie, he would tell other people to tell his wives he was divorcing, because he couldn't confront. So all these fears that we're just living in, I mean, we're just like, oh. It takes such courage to be our own person. Mm-hmm. One baby step at a time, sweetheart. Isn't it? Who else? Yeah.
What do you do with self-hatred when you feel, when you know you've hurt other people and you...
When you know you've hurt other people. Well, that's where the process of purification comes in.
Yeah.
The first step is to have the courage to acknowledge that I did that wrong thing. And that takes stupendous courage as well. Because we either want to blame the other person, or then we just have guilt, which turns against us, and we just kill ourselves. But we've got to acknowledge I did something wrong, because I'm deluded, I'm attached, I'm angry, I'm neurotic, join the club. And I did do that harm, but I regret it. You were there the weekend.
Yeah.
So you didn't hear any of the teachings. I talked an awful lot for those 8 hours. I thought I was giving you the methods. Darling, I understand. I know, it does go. This takes time, all this stuff. It means acknowledging courageously. You know, like with you. What's your name, darling?
Me? Mm-hmm. Hillary.
Hillary. So let's say Hillary was mean to her mum one time. Join the club again. So then to have the courage to bravely own the fact that you did shoot your mouth off, and don't blame your mum because she's neurotic and needy, which is what we want to do. We want to sort of give ourselves a reason for doing it, to get ourselves off the hook. But just be courageous to own the fact that particular time I didn't make my mum happy, you know, and don't not just get a guilt because your mummy looked unhappy because she knew she was mean to her mum, she was unkind with her words. Then to acknowledge it in her own heart, you know. That I did the wrong thing, and then regret it because you're sick of the suffering from this, you don't want the habit, and then you have compassion, and then you try to purify. Whatever it is in our mind, we have to own it. All the rubbish, all the junk, and this is why my feeling is, Hillary, and you too here for sure. The irony of ego is we are addicted to the negative voices. We're addicted to the misery. The moment someone doesn't like me, the moment my friend, my boyfriend rejects me, instantly I don't get mad at him. If I'm the frank one, I don't get mad at him. I think I must be a creep. I'm nobody. I'm nothing. I'm no good. He must have rejected me because I'm a garbage person. That's the self-hate we all have. And that's just the internalized anger. And that's just as bad as the other anger, except at least with that anger, you don't harm somebody else as well, which is what Frank did. So to hear it, because it's also not true. This is something else again. It's not true because somebody else decides they don't like me. Does not mean I'm not a worthy person. But this is really hard for us if we're junkies for other people to approve of us. So it's so complex, so tricky in there, all these little tricky, tricky little voices all working away, you know. But to acknowledge, whatever it is, to acknowledge it. Because until you acknowledge the problem, you can't find the solution. So you've got to give it the right name, label it as a weed. Maybe it can't be pulled out yet, you know. Maybe it's a big sort of like a oak tree size weed. First know it's a weed, and then learn to live with it. And that's the part, because then what happens is we see anger, and then we get angry about being angry, and then we just have this vicious circle.
Yeah.
So it's so tricky, you know. It's so tricky. Someone else was here, yeah.
I really get what you're saying about to be careful about, you know, just because something feels good doesn't mean it's the right thing. You know?
Yep, that's right. It's a hard one to see.
Yeah, I get it intellectually.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, but what about like intuition?
What about it?
Well, the way I experience intuition is sort of like a combination of thought and feeling.
Sure, I understand that. So it's a feeling that something's right, is it?
It's a feeling that's based on...
A feeling that's right. Well, let me give you an example.
Yeah.
Let me give you an example. I always quote this. I remember reading about this 19-year-old white supremacist. When he first read Hitler, I felt I'd come home. It was just perfect. I could not believe everything fell into place. It was so right. I knew I'd found my home. That's intuition, baby. And so... That's not valid, just because it feels good. This is even my point. Intuition even, something that just instinctively feels good, it all depends on what the habit is in your mind. So for the person, you know, this is one of karma, bringing the Buddhist view of karma. You're programmed, you're wired, as Michael put it. Okay, he's got a different view of wiring. I'm just using the Buddhist view, Michael, of wiring. You bring your own wiring. So there's this example of this friend of mine who told me about her little boy who from the time he saw fishing, okay, Buddha, I'm not being rude about fishermen, but the Buddha would suggest that any action where we kill another being is not cool. Okay, so killing, so there you are born with it. He was born, we can deduce that he was born with a tendency to kill from having killed in the past. And the tendency is what we call instinct. So the moment at the age of 3 or something that he saw fishing, it was like he recognized it. Just like the 19-year-old with Hitler. And it looked amazing, which meant he had the karmic connection. It saw it. I saw fishing, but I walked right past it. I didn't want to fish. You understand my point?
Yeah.
So he saw it. It triggered a good feeling. And, of course, if it feels good, baby, and it was very intuitive. His little boy, he couldn't analyze it all. He just knew he wanted to go fishing. And he just spent his life going fishing and feeling really good. Well, you could say that's virtually intuitive. Intuitive is very, Buddhist view, very deep habit from having done it or thought it or said it before. So it doesn't follow that it's wise. It doesn't follow that it is. But you can deduce that if you're following morality and kindness and goodness, that you are getting a bit better, that you can trust to some wisdom there, trust some intuition there. But in itself, it's not especially a holy thing. Look at the white supremacist one. I find that such a good example. It's whatever the tendency in your own mind are, whatever you're wiring, it's that you've brought with you. So that's why the basic here, this is where the basis, okay, in our world, the feeling is because we are these attachment bodies that crave good feelings. The basis we tend to have of what is good and what is not good is if it feels good. So we all learn morality. We learn from our mummy, don't kill, don't lie, don't this, don't that. And we often would say, you just know it's wrong. Well, it doesn't follow. You've got to have the wiring in there from your own past habit of what is moral. So even if mummy didn't tell you that lying was wrong, you just feel bad, a naughty girl, you know. So that means you've got morality wiring. So that's your basis. So not only following attachment, because if it feels good, it must be good, which is the one that's hard to resist. Then we've got to have our other view here. So let's say we listen to the Buddhist one, lying, killing, stealing, blah, blah, or Jesus' teachings, lying, stealing, killing. You have to then refer, oh, I feel good here and I want to go kill somebody. Oh, I better check my little list here and don't kill. Uh-oh, it says don't kill. So now the conflict comes, now the practice comes. Going against my feeling to kill because I have decided that it's valid to practice morality. So if you're programmed with it. Listen, the other example I always quote, my friend with a little boy, 3 years old again, she was taking the lice out of his head and he's crying with compassion for the lice. Mummy, mummy, don't hurt them, it's their home, leave them alone. He was doing everything she could, he could. Now that we could say is intuitive compassion, but where from? From his own past practice. So instinctive, that it was, and he's never killed a living being in his life. He's now 30 or 40 or something. So this is why the view of karma is Buddhist view is very helpful to explain why in the first place we have these feelings or want to do this or want to do that. Whereas in the West we say, okay, it's wiring. Michael's got his own view. The materialist wiring is, well, it must come from daddy, mummy, and we haven't found why Hitler's wiring is there yet. We haven't worked out what his wiring is. You understand? Mm-hmm. But the Buddha says the wiring is true, but it's our own wiring.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Do you see?
Yeah, I do.
So we always have to assess. That's why to have a valid basis for making our choices. Not just because it feels good. Aren't you lucky that if you've got morality and it also feels good? Wow, that's really, you're on the roll now. And you just, then your wisdom's intuitive. Then it's perfect because you've practiced to perfection. So when you've learned all that music and you've got Bach completely down, you can just play it without worry because you know every note you're playing is perfect, but you've practiced for years to get it perfect.
Mm-hmm.
So now it's virtually instinctive, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Someone else? Yes.
In the context, maybe of last week, but the question she asked...
And
Marianne. The question Marianne asked, self-loathing, guilt.
Yes.
Not regret,
yes.
But self-loathing,
yes.
And guilt.
Yes.
In terms of the purification,
yes.
When do you let... We talked, you know, three out of five,
yes.
Hail Mary, it's all gone. But when do you let go? Purification,
yes.
At least in my case,
mm-hmm.
Can become a manifestation of self-loathing itself.
No, if you're
not doing it right.
No, I think, well, the first step has to be regret, which is regretting that you did it because you're sick of suffering. It's kindness to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have compassion because they're suffering, the one you harmed. Then you do the practice and then you vow not to do it again. But we can see that every day you do this practice, it's like it's called practice because you're practicing. It's
yeah.
Not perfect yet. So you've got to keep practicing every day saying, I will never kill, until eventually that will be so instinctive in you that you'll end up next life with like this little boy who just already has compassion for the lice in his own head. So there is a point where you can say you've perfected it. So in Buddhist view, perfecting all these things takes quite a while. So you've got to keep saying it and doing it every day.
And it's more of a prospective process as a retrospective process. You're not trying to have, something forgiven, but you're trying to purify so it doesn't happen.
Basically, you're acknowledging the old habits
mm.
that have caused you suffering and caused you to harm others. You regret them because you're sick of suffering and you have compassion because you're thinking of others.
Mm.
And then you're training your mind to say every day, I will never kill again. So it's like every day you sit down to play piano, you get a bit better at it, don't you?
Yes. No.
That's a process of learning, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the same here. Every day you say, I'll never kill, you keep increasing that groove in your mind till eventually you've accomplished that to perfection. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's a ongoing, incremental, step-by-step mental process of perfection to the point where there's no longer even a skerrick of a thought to ever want to kill again. When you've perfected your mind, that's what Buddha means by nirvana. When you've achieved that, you've perfected your own positive habits and you've completely removed the negative habits. So it's a gradual, ongoing mental process of thoughts and practicing until eventually you've made it perfect. You see what I'm saying? What else? Yes. Camilla.
It sometimes seems that one of the things that can create challenges to stepping fully into a life that would make us very, very happy is the fact that so many people around us are so desperately unhappy.
Yes.
And sometimes people that are very close to us. So that it's as if empathy masquerading as compassion can almost have us jumping in the ditch a bit with them. And there's almost a bit of guilt in embracing fully what makes us very happy.
I'm a bit confused, Camilla. I'm partially hearing, but I don't want to misunderstand, so if you can say it another way for me. Okay, well, here we are living in our lives, we're social creatures, and for sure we have people around us, our loved ones, and some of them sometimes are suffering. Is that what you're saying?
That's
right. Okay, good. So then?
So allowing ourselves to be very, very happy is sometimes a challenge.
Oh, I see. Okay, so we need to analyze here then. Can you tell me what you mean by allowing ourselves to be happy? What do you mean by that, do you think? What do you think you mean by that?
By embracing fully the life that...
Our spiritual practice, you mean?
spiritual practice being being part of it, but also making all the choices, embracing all the choices in life that make us very happy when others around us.
Need to know what you mean by very happy, because it sounds pretty intense. Very happy, Camilla. I'm not trying to be boring here. What do you mean by very happy? I'm sorry. I have to ask you.
Fulfilled.
Okay, good. All right. So it's an but surely until we've got a Buddhist view would be until you quite highly realize you won't be really fulfilled, but it's a process of becoming fulfilled. Would you accept that?
Sure.
So making the choices that we want to make to become the fulfilled person that we feel we know we can become. Is that what you're saying?
Sure.
Right. So you're saying we hold back from doing that because we feel guilty because our brother's an alcoholic or something.
Sure.
Okay, is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay. And that's the attachment to reputation. That's the one I'm talking about.
Really?
It's attachment, worried about what they think. Yeah, that's all it is. Because the point is this, darling. If you really want to practice the compassion wing, which is to help your beloved brother, you have to do the wisdom wing, which is working on yourself, which is you becoming the person you must become, which means the fulfilled person. Because how the name of Jesus, God, excuse me, help an unfulfilled person help anybody? You'll just drown with him. So, of course, it's attachment. It's fear and guilt, which is attached to what people think of me. How can I go off and be happy? Well, I mean, that's a very interesting view. A person I know who's, it doesn't matter who it is, a friend, somebody, and they had her husband, who very, angry with lots of things in the world, all the suffering and all the abuse and all of this, and the pedophile priest and all this, blah, 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 whatever. They're involved in all that. They actually say, we can never be happy until everybody, as long as someone else is suffering. So we see it as almost like, it's wrong to feel content. That's the problem. We think you've got to feel bad as long as everyone else is suffering. But my point is feeling bad means guilty, attached, angry, neurotic, and that means unfulfilled. And that means how can that person help anybody? You've got to have wisdom, and wisdom means clarity and joy. Wisdom means making the choices that will quit my delusions. That's what brings fulfillment. So the thing is, if I think of someone like the Dalai Lama who's said to be an enlightened being, okay? Now, everyone can see that he's got every reason in ordinary worldly terms to be out of his brain with anger. His country's been destroyed and continues to be for 50 years now. His people coming out every single day and he's in tears of compassion in Dharamsala, all these exiles still continuing to come. The country, you understand? So. But he's hilariously funny. He's completely joyful. He laughs, he cracks jokes. He's obviously a really happy person. But he has immense compassion. So there's no contradiction. And it's only the person who's gone beyond neurosis, who's the person who's fearless, who's the person who's really happy, who is the person who can be really loving and compassionate. It's just logic. When we think of it this way, it's a crime not to become happy. Because happy means wise. And wise is the person who can help others. If it's the happy to go off and be happy on your own, yes, that's different. That's selfish. But this one, the two wings, this happy is gives you the ability to be able to help others be happy, and you'll never give up making them happy, but you'll be happy on the way. Because if you're not, you'll drag them all to death with you. You'll all drown together, dear. What good is that? One of the characteristics of a bodhisattva is this courage to never give up. Optimism. I sort of put it, you've got to stay perky. My philosophy is even if you're drowning, you might as well stay happy. Because then at least you might still find some solution, you know? And why die miserable? You might as well be happy. Not kidding. It's so logic. But it's just very scary again because we're worried about what people think. How can I be happy if someone else is still miserable? Like you're looking like you're being selfish, you know? Mm-hmm. And that's only because you think other people think you're being selfish. It's all to do with attachment to reputation. So what do you think? 10 to 9. Time to go home, my gosh. Food for thought. Let's just sit for 3 minutes and do a quiet little watching our minds, okay? Little tiny watching our thoughts. This is going to be so simple, but it'll be embarrassing. You think you're not doing it properly. So all I want you to do is close your eyes, be normal. Don't get all holy because you're going to meditate. Just be normal, close your eyes, and simply observe whatever arises in your mind. Don't get involved in it. Don't have a conversation. And of course, if you do, choose to shut up and just keep observing. Just for 3 quality minutes, you simply observe whatever arises in your mind. And no comments, no discussion, no commentary, just thoughts. Observe the thoughts. And let them come, and let them go. And stay very sharp and focused. So now we just finish with some optimistic thoughts, you know, remembering that our thoughts are our own. We need to learn to know them because they're the source of whatever goes on in our lives. And we've got this amazing potential that the Buddha would say anyway, that all these neuroses are not at the core of our being, as big and loud as they are, seemingly running the show. They're not at the core of our being. They're not who we really are. So this is, for me, is a very powerful point, because it should give us such optimism, such courage, you know. The virtuous thoughts, the positive thoughts, the goodness, the love, the compassion, the wisdom, the clarity, the courage, all of these are at the core of our being, and they're connected to reality. The illusions are completely separate from reality. They're insane, you know. They're in la-la land. So to have this confidence, and therefore this courage, and therefore this perseverance, you know, to never give up, using the tools that we choose to use, whatever the tools, you know, it might be Buddhist tools, it might not, I don't mind, that's your call. To become who you really are, to become this amazing being, and then you're qualified to be a benefit to others, because we're all in this boat together. And if I don't do it, who will? So no choice. Just keep going. Just keep moving. Never giving up. One step at a time. Kewaji nyu du dai lama sangge tru kyu ne tru wa chi kyang ma lu pa te Chob sam chogren poche, ma ke panam ke gyoji, ke panyam pa me payam, gong ne gong du ba wa shu. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. this is a group offering from the group.
Oh, yeah? Thank you, Sharon. Thank you, group.
Venerable Robina, can't thank you enough for being here yet once again
at
Kurukulla Center. We are so grateful. Venerable Robina, on behalf of Kurukulla Center, thank you. Please stay healthy. Please stay warm. Please come back soon.
Well, I'm just telling Sean that my last summer was June 2012 and my next summer will be June 2015 in Boston. I will have had winters for 3 years. A little kind of hint of spring when I cross over somewhere, but I've changed my directions. In June I'll be back in 2015. Right. You're gone in a second. It'll be the summer. What's that room upstairs at the front of my room? I love that room. I'm telling you, one of the favourite. I don't like. I'm not necessarily a fan of Medford. I'm not being rude or anything. Definitely a fan of that room. It's one of my favourite rooms in all the Buddhist centres around the world. I'm very content. If I had to do a 5-year retreat, I'd happily choose that room. I love it.
We'll have your room ready.
Okay.